The spirit is like a container and the contents are spirit and life. When that content starts to leak, it can only start to leak because the container called the spirit is injured. When it's injured, it begins to leak out. And what it leaks out life. So you have people living in despair, in discouragement. You have people living in confusion. You have people living in a state of hopelessness. All that is what we call, the Bible calls it, Proverbs 15 verse 13, it calls it a crushed spirit. A crushed spirit cannot sustain life. So what does it do? It rejects life. That means you can be so deeply wounded by the issues of life that it actually permeates into your spirit and crushes your spirit. What that translates to is you reject life. You start to just peter out, leak out. You find someone starts to lose weight, and then it's food. But they can't eat it, because the will to eat is gone, so is the appetite. They eat food, it's like plastic. That's a crushed spirit. Let's go to Proverbs 18:14. The human spirit will endure sickness, but a broken or a crushed spirit, who can bear? I think another version of the NIV says, a man's spirit sustains him through sickness. I'm sure you've seen people who have gone through difficult things and have come out. That function, even if they were in a coma, the spirit refused to give up on life. Said, no. I am fighting back. And I am not going to quit. There are people who medical science cannot explain why they're still alive. Because as far as the prognosis and the diagnosis went, they were dead. But one day they just came back. People are like, you're here? You say, yeah, I'm here. What happened? He said, somewhere in the deep recesses of my spirit, I refused to quit. Then there are also people who just quit. So it doesn't matter what you do for them. They will just go south. And you put them in a casket and you bury them. What happened? That function got destroyed. Okay. Let me go, of course, to the soul, which is what the Bible calls the heart. And we are all familiar with a broken heart because, you know, psychology, which comes from the word psyche. Psyche is psychology which deals with the soul. Matters of the soul. And of course, secular psychology does not give spiritual solutions to the conditions of the soul. I just need to make that clear here. That if you study psychology, really I'm not against you, but I want you to know that there are solutions which are mainly worldly, that avoid God's prescribed solutions. Okay? So if you study clinical or counseling psychology, you need to first know your Bible well, so that the conditions that people bring to you, you can be able to give them scripture. Even if secular psychology tells you you should not prescribe things, you need to give people the word, because that's what will happen. The soul cannot pull by itself, it needs the spirit, and it can pull the spirit down, because the soul is like a mediator between the body and the spirit. When it crashes, a huge thing has crashed. We said it's the seat of the mind, the will, and the emotions. A broken mind is called a confused mind. It's also called a split mind. And the Greek word is schizophrenia. Schizo is to split. Fren is the mind. Schizophrenia. Schizophrenia is when that particular entity called the mind, which is in charge of A, intellectual data, and processing, B, spiritual thinking, and personality DNA. And C is also in charge of the whole consciousness of the body and the spirit when it is damaged. Then you begin to have strange things. People begin to hear strange voices where people are not talking. And what usually has happened is because your mind is deeply injured, and this is mental health, those of you who are mental health will know, because your mind is deeply injured, your consciousness has basically become double. So you are seeing things which people cannot see. A lot of them see spiritual things and start talking to spiritual entities. And because the discerning mind or the discerning eye cannot see, they say you're mad because you're talking to yourself. You're really not talking to yourself. Most of the time, these people are talking to spirit entities. And they need to resolve the invasion into their mind by the spirit entities and the circumstantial entities. What you're coming to is heaven. Then your choices will be sound. But today we have a lot more people making bad choices because of the damage inside. Right? Because of the damage inside. And so you have confusion. That's one disease of the will. Procrastination is another disease of the will. Taking too long to make decisions. Okay, so confusion is making too many decisions. Procrastination is making no decisions. Then rebellion is making the wrong decisions. Three diseases of the will. Confusion, procrastination, rebellion. Let me add a third one. Let me add a fourth one to that question. The fourth one is something called stubbornness. Stubbornness and rebellion are not the same, but they are related. They are very close relatives. They're like twins. They're not identical. Rebellion is when you outrightly reject the authority of God and any other legitimate authority. That's rebellion. Most Christians really don't do that. Unless, of course, somebody has really hurt them, they don't do that. But there's something called stubbornness. Stubbornness is doing God's things our way. That's what many people do. Stubbornness is defined as a strong will that refuses to submit. So God will say something, and this is really what caused the first generation of Israelites, the Egypt generation, that's what caused them their destiny. It was they wanted to do God's things, but they told him, hey, wait a minute, we're going to do it on our terms. God said, no, you're not going to do it on your terms. You will do it, and you will do it on my terms. And if you won't do it on my terms, then that's it. You will perish in this desert, each and every one of you, except for Joshua and Caleb. So stubbornness is what kills us. And you know, God has already given his prescription on the two. In 1 Samuel 15, verse 22 and 23. 1 Samuel 15, verse 22 and 23. Verse 22, he says, has the Lord any delight in sacrifice as he has in obedience? And he said, for to obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed better than the fat of rams. And then he says, for rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and arrogance or stubbornness as the sin of idolatry. And then he concludes, Samuel concludes that, by saying, you have rejected the word of the Lord, he has rejected you from being king. And so basically, stubbornness is King Saul, 1 Samuel 15, he still goes, utterly destroying the Amalekites, everything that has breath in it, kill it, extinguish it. He goes, and then he sees, pretty woman, keep that. Agag, I need Agag, I need somebody strategic. So he keeps the king, he keeps the cows, he keeps the goats. He keeps everything that looks good. And then he destroys everything that doesn't look so good. Then he comes to Samuel. He meets Samuel and says, Samuel, hey, I have done what the Lord says I should do. And Samuel asks him one question, past his Bible. What is the bleating of sheep that I hear? And then he says, those are us. Okay. The men, the army, yeah, they thought it was prudent for us to not kill them. But you know, we can save our economy some money because you see, your God, let us have a kidogo when we have to sacrifice all these things. So we're going to sacrifice these things to the Lord, your God. Okay? But he did talk about the women that the soldiers had taken. He did talk about Agag, whom he had taken for political reasons. And someone tells him, hold on, I'm going to tell you the word of the Lord. And he says, say your name. That's where he begins verse 22. He says, has the Lord any delight? Stubbornness is a disease of it. It's when you hear the word of the Lord. You have heard it. And let me tell you, most of the time, the word of the Lord will not make logical, please write that word down, logical sense. But you will receive it in your spirit. And you will know the Lord has said this. But when you pass it through the framework of logic, or the log frame, it fails the test of logic. And you say, that can't be God. So I'm going to go back for fresh instruction. And if I don't get it, I will do what I know how to do. That's called stubbornness. But sometimes, things are rather clear. It's not even that it has failed the logical test. You just know, God has said this, but that, I'm not going to do it. Because then, yeah, I'm struggling with it. So, hey, let's just say, I will do it. Stubbornness. So, yeah, those diseases of the will. And then we have the emotions. This is where many things live. Emotions get damaged, and mainly through relationships and life circumstances. Two things that really, really damage emotions. Relationships, failed relationships, and unfortunate adverse circumstances. Those things damage us. They produce bitterness. The chief among all those agents of spiritual, of damage, agents of emotional damage, the chief of them is led by someone called bitterness. And I usually say, if Satan has not made you bitter, he can't overcome you, he can't conquer you. You won't. We could do a whole series just on bitterness. But what is bitterness? Bitterness is the refusal not just to let go of a grudge, but it is the choice to visit revenge. It is both the refusal to let go of a grudge and the choice to revenge. Visit revenge on the people who hurt you. There's passive ways of revenge, and there's aggressive ways of revenge. Aggressive ways of revenge, shouting at people, beating people, blah, 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 those are rather obvious. The passive ones are the ones many Christians practice. It's avoidance, so I'll not take your call. I'll politely refuse to greet you. So I see you and I scat you. I see he is there. All right, and the door is there. Let's do our math. I'll go this way. I'll talk to this one here. And I know he is right. I can calculate the vector of where he is. At that point, my eyes are like a chameleon's eyes because now they're on this side. I can see unidirectionally. And multi-direction. And eventually, you leave that exit without greeting them. Day one, you feel achieved. Yes. Because most of us ask the wrong questions. We ask, what did you do? We ask, what did you say? I did nothing. And we think that nothing usually constitutes no offense. Right? We think that the quality zero means there is no value to it. And that's not true. When I refuse to talk to you, I dishonor you. Mm-hmm. When I refuse to talk to you, I dishonor you. It's an offense before God. When I refuse to look out for you and to care for you, I dishonor you. Because God has commanded us not to be, we're cool, I'm fine. And you know, we usually, aren't we smart, but foolish at the same time? What do we say? I don't have a problem. I don't have a problem. If he has a problem, tell me. But you will not go and look to him. You will not find him. You won't call him. You will not call her. Why? Because he had me. Because he had me. I will call him. Those are passive ways of getting even. Someone apologizes and you drag them right through the guilt trip. And you make the trip long, winded, and very full of contours and landscapes. They apologize and say, well, yeah, please forgive me. Yeah, so when you are doing this thing, what were you thinking? And let me tell you, the tragedy is this. The tragedy is that some people become permanently warped by bitterness. It becomes a lifestyle. And the one thing that bitterness does is that it steals relationships. It's a poison that can never coexist with relationships. It doesn't matter who hurt you, there will always be a secondary victim who is projected upon. So for instance, you're in a relationship with a man, he hurts you, breaks your heart, then you say, yeah, I've dealt with it, I'm fine. That's what we do. I always tell people, rewind. How did you deal with it? Because many of us think the passage of time heals. Let me correct that today once and for all. Time does not heal. Can I say that again in English? Time does not heal. Neither does it make you forget. If you're wounded, every day you think about that man, and every day you'll be thinking about inventing ways of killing him. The passage of time will not help you. No matter how hard you try to push it down your memory will keep simmering with bitterness and woundedness. And then you meet a guy who has nothing to do with your issues. And he wants to marry you. Where does he touch the wound? But listen, you denied the wound when you said you dealt with it. This is what is causing people a lot of problems in relationships. How to deal with your ex in the framework of your present. I can never stand a man doing this to me. I can never stand a man doing that. I don't do exes. I don't do it. The drama begins. Afro cinema starts now. Sit back and watch the repeat of the previous relationship in the current one. The poor man or the poor woman gets beaten for all those things that are not his or hers. And by the time you're done with them, they wonder, what did I ever do to you? In situations like this, where did we go wrong so badly? It's not you. This person never dealt with the damage of the previous. And let me tell you this for free. Many people, when they fall in love the first time, they fall hard. And they give their all. When it breaks equally hard. Then many people do not have the capacity to deal with the heartbreak. So they tuck that broken heart neatly away. And then somebody comes to want to transact with that heart, which is still broken. And the moment they touch, you go, you say, but I love you, and I want to touch your heart. You say, hey, careful. Then you touch it. I guess that's why we're here. I will not become dramatic about that. I have moved on from bitterness. So it's a refusal to let go of a grudge. What is a grudge? A grudge comes from an offense. So somebody offends you, then the offense wounds you, or it injures you. Then from injury, and I haven't begun my subheading, so don't write anything down. Just like this is part of what, I do not know what section of the summary I'm on. So don't write it, just write it. So the wound, unchecked, and the only thing that checks wounds is forgiveness, unchecked, and becomes a grudge. Okay? The grudge, unchecked, becomes what? Bitterness. Bitterness, unchecked, becomes frustration. Frustration is when you begin to take things out of people. Eh? Frustration, unchecked, and please check down, go down that spiral. Frustration, unchecked, becomes depression. Depression is when you really can't take out things on people, whether they're too big for you, or you respect them too much, or you're the one who doesn't have the strength. So you turn all that venom inside. Depression is anger turned inward. You turn it on yourself. So it hurts your entire emotional fabric. Depression, unchecked, becomes despair. Now, depression is what cracks the soul and cracks into the spirit. And then the spirit begins to crash. So it becomes despair. Because despair is in the spirit now. Now you're in the spirit. Despair, unchecked, becomes discouragement. By the time you're doing discouragement, you have lost the will to fight, the zest to live, the enthusiasm to attempt. You're just walking. You don't think, you don't respond. You're not excited, everything is gone. Discouragement checked becomes suicide. It's a downward spiral. So when you see a guy has committed suicide, please bring back that spiral. It started with an offense. Many, several offenses. Many, many offenses. To another reason of time. Okay, so that's the emotions. And I've just touched on bitterness. There's fear, there's rejection. Oh, that mercy. And rejection is a huge monster. Rejection is the following. It's difficult to define it with one definition. So I'm going to give you several definitions. Right? Watch my time, because I haven't gone to the main body of my son. Watch my time, right? What is rejection? Rejection is feeling unwanted. It's definition one, feeling unwanted. Number two, it's feeling like you're not good enough. Feeling like you're not good enough. Number three, feeling excluded. It's like you're outside and you're looking in. And when people do things, you're not part of it. And everybody is happy, you're not happy. So you're not good enough. You're not good enough to be so and so into so and so's life or in so and so's family. Rejection is the sole weapon that Satan uses to destroy our selfhood. Your selfhood is your self-welfare. It's when you have good self-esteem, good self-image, good self-appreciation, a healthy self-love, you know. Rejection not only robs you, it plunders you. Everything that's in your selfhood is taken. So you now have low self-esteem or no self-esteem. Poor self-image. Inferiority complex. For some, they have superiority complex. That's also rejection. They become so rejected, they want to over-exert and prove a point. And some people are super achievers who have an empty heart. Because the motivation for that achievement was always, I was rejected, I'm going to prove to anyone I'm not what they said. And so you put your ladder against this wall, and you climb the achievement wall, and you get all the way to the top, and you realize your heart is still empty. Because you started on a deficit called rejection. And so I say, go ahead and achieve, but first let the Lord fix your heart. So that when you achieve with a full heart. Rejection is a terrible thing. Plunders your house. People who are rejected end up empty. They can be in a relationship that is supposed to be fulfilling, but they are still empty. They are in a relationship, they are like a tick. And you know, usually a tick needs a host. Whether the host is a cow or a dog. When you're in a relationship with a rejected person and you are not rejected, you are the host. The tick never contributes anything to the host. It feeds off the host. I think I like the Swahili word, fionza. It fions us and sucks the life out of that person. And when it has sucked, it is not any fuller than when it began. Because it has no capacity to fill. The capacity was destroyed by rejection. Until rejection is removed, there is nothing that can fill the heart of that person. You can love that person till your nose bleeds. They will not fill your heart. Such is the exploit of rejection. Still, you can lavish that person with everything. You can tell them I love you, but they'll just look at you and say, I don't believe you. It can make you feel so terrible if you're in a relationship with them. Because try as you want. They will not only will they tell you I don't believe you, they'll start accusing you of being in other relationships. Oh, the way you look at so and so. Oh, the way you talk to so and so. Oh, the way you engage, you just seem to connect with them, not me. It's rejection. But thank God, He takes away our rejection. When God has done it, I'm telling you, you enter into a relationship and you get fulfilled. Because of rejection, many relationships end up being just physical. But there's no meaningful connection. You even have rejection-afflicted marriages. Where people are just, they just look good together. Ah, oh, you guys, you look so, oh, look at that. But the thing has ravaged their hearts. Okay? I'm only going to write those three. That's bitterness, rejection, fear. They are many. They may not touch their hearts. And then, of course, we have the body. And I told you those ones you can take to hospital. They said, body is what? Blood, bone, and tissue. Remember that? And the physical anatomy, I think doctors have the capability to handle. But I want you to know this. There are some diseases that are on the body that have not have a root in the body. They have a root either in the psyche, that is the soul, or they have a root in the spirit. And so you have to treat the stuff in the spirit and in the soul first before the body can be well. That's the only right I will add. The only things that respond to medical science are the things that have a root in the physical anatomy. If the ailment or the affliction or the oppression has a root in the soul, it has to be given soul medication. If it has a root in the spirit, it has to be given what?
Spirit.
There's no tablet that drives out demons. When you can go and say, do you have an anti-demonite? Or an anti-addictionite that I can take, and then the addiction will. Spiritual things are spiritually designed, spiritually applied, and spiritually engaged. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
I'm going to take you then through the journey of wounding. Okay? Journey of wounding. The journey of wounding begins in utero. Write the word utero. U-T-E-R-O. Utero. Utero means womb. The womb. The womb. Baby, a baby in the womb is very aware of its internal surroundings and external surroundings. There's a Canadian doctor called Thomas Verney, V-E-R-N-Y. He's written a book called The Secret Life of the Unborn Child. It's a book worth reading. The Secret Life of the Unborn Child, Thomas Verney, V-E-R-N-Y. And in that book he says, unborn babies, here and they know what goes on. They can feel the feelings of the mother towards them. They can also feel the feelings of the father towards them when they know. You can find something like that in Luke chapter 1. When Mary went to visit Elizabeth, what happened? John the Baptist said hi to Jesus. The baby in Elizabeth's womb leaped for joy the moment Mary greeted Elizabeth. That's one of the few womb activities recorded in scripture. There's a lot of womb activity. A gynecologist will tell you that. Those who deal with babies in the womb will tell you babies are very smart, even when they're in the womb. But wounding happens in the womb. Words that mothers say about the child. Words that fathers say about the child. This baby is coming at a wrong time. Can't believe I'm pregnant. Especially when it's a teen pregnancy. Can't believe I'm pregnant. The mother's fear goes into the spirit of the baby. And it becomes not just fear, it also becomes a rejection. So by the time the baby comes out, they have what you call utero wounds. Utero wounds are very difficult to design until the baby starts to grow. And then you find that they're having, you know, they're prone to sickness, they're prone to accidents, they're prone to misfortunes. What's going on in this baby's life? And sometimes parents have called me as a minister of deliverance and said, my baby is going through this. I tell them, bring that baby. It's a 6-month-old, 7-month-old, 1-year-old. Just seem to cry endlessly, throw things, throw tantrums. I ask them, are you guys mistreating this baby the same way? I say, okay, bring that baby. I begin to speak to that baby. I begin to speak to the utero wounds. And I ask that baby to forgive the parents for the words they said. And the baby begins to cry. And when we are done with healing, that baby's life changes completely. Because we think that babies cannot express things in words, we think that their spirit is equally undeveloped. That's not true. Babies are one of the most developed spirits. The other functions may be still in evolution, but their spirits are very sharp. They pick up things. They pick up things. And because the only thing they can do is cry and act up, they'll act up. So there's utero. I can't do any more than that because of time. So utero wounding. Then there is early childhood wounding. And in early childhood wounding, we have, you know, unstable marriages. When parents fight, things like those. They expose children to a lot of fear and insecurity. That's actually where the seed of rejection is sown. the lives of people. The fear of abandonment, parents keep saying, I'm going to leave you and your babies. The other one says, leave when you think I'll die. Leave, go. Even tomorrow. The baby is listening. One day we interacted. I've also death of parents when the babies are still very young. They may not have the mental comprehension, but in their spirit, they understand grief. They know something terrible has happened that has to do with their destiny. Those need to be mitigated. Early childhood. Then you have what you call late childhood wounding. And late childhood wounding begins maybe from about age 7 going on. By this time, the child is fairly well developed, has reached the age of reason. The age of reason is 7. That's where people are supposed to begin school. Parents take people to standard 1 at age 4. And that is what you call foundational education. That happens in your house. Foundational education is when you lay the foundation for that child's life, the rest. Do not compromise on foundations. Because we're dealing with parents now who are children out of home. Let me also say something for you, but to you free of charge. Don't take your primary school going children to boarding school. Don't do it. You'll destroy it. Some people at age 9 are shipped out of home. The time they come back home, they are 19. They don't know how to be in a home. They can never settle in a relationship. Because a home, you cannot teach those kids in school. You cannot teach relationships in school. People are asking, why is it that people don't want to get married anymore? I tell them, they don't have the skills. They ask me, what do you mean? They don't have the skills. So their marriage is a relationship. People have no clue how to relate. Why? Because the place where relationship is modeled and taught is the home. You ask yourself, the person you're going out with, when did they leave home? Maybe you'll take some money. Most people are not willing to admit that they don't have a skill as basic as a relationship. It's too embarrassing to admit. But the sooner you admit it, then you just say, man, I'm poor at this thing called relationships. I need to learn. Go. Yugosh, Bishop, please, set up a series. It's not just love relationships. There's that container called relationships. And in it you have, you know, father-mother relationship, you have, you know, sister-brother relationships. What are they? What are those things? Because they have an economy. They are an economy unto themselves. They teach us how to engage with the world around us. And they teach us how to engage with the people that are going to be close to us in the future. If that template is not put in you, then you don't have a sense of what family is. And when you don't have a sense of what family is, you dwell alone. You can be in a crowd, make everyone laugh, but nobody really knows who you are. Psalm 68. I like reading this. Psalm 68. Oh Lord, have mercy on me. Make the sun stand still. Hallelujah. I'm still going to try and finish it. Psalm 68, verse 5 and 6. Is someone getting blessed by this?
Yes.
All right, let's try this. All right. Psalm 68, verse 5 and 6. It says, a father of the fatherless, a defender of widows, is God in his holy habitation. God places the lonely in families, but leads out the prisoners to prosperity. But the rebellious live in a parched land. So what does God do with you and I? He places us in what? Families. He takes you. You see, man, you dwell alone. He'll give you a covenant brother. He'll give you a covenant sister. Before he gives you that covenant person to dwell with, he has to put in that template called covenant. So you understand how covenant informs relationships. Because unless you understand the template called covenant, you will not understand the thing called relationships, and you will therefore be zero when it comes to marriage. Have I met sense? Marriage is a covenant relationship. So in marriage, you need to understand covenant, and you need to understand what? Relationships. In order for you to be married. Marriage is not sustained by falling in love. No. Falling in love will end the first year. You will feel it. You will feel your marriage maybe for a year if you are lucky. You will feel it. After a while, you stop feeling. That's why it's got to start deeper than a feeling. So if you are falling in love, God bless you. It's okay. Enjoy the feelings while they last. But let me be clear so that I don't confuse you. The feelings don't go away. They are designed to settle down. They settle down. So the need for you to keep stirring them up. That's what we call cherishing in marriage. We cherish. Huh? It's called cherishing. Now if you don't understand that, you will say, I used to love you, now I don't. I don't know, I just don't feel you anymore. I don't know, it's not the way it was. Then you move on to someone, and the first 6-7 months, you're like, oh, this is, ooh, and then, you get married, and the thing again settles down. Okay. What's wrong with you? No, it's not what's wrong with you, the person you're going out with. It's your lack of understanding. You do not have the template. Understand that covenants are matters of conviction before their feelings. They start off with a conviction. Hey, I'm putting my chair. Why? Hiya. Jaribu yote na. They start off with a conviction. I trust myself. They start off with a conviction that is deep inside of you. So that even when the feeling wears off, you know this is the one I was meant to be with. You know me. So marriage is a knowing. That's what the Bible says, that Adam knew his wife. It's a knowing. It's something you feel deep in your bones, not just feel, but you know it. You wake up at 3, boom, you ask, is it so and so? You say, yes, it is. How do you know? I just know. It fails the test of logic because it's no longer logical. It's a conviction. You can never take that thing out of that person. Never. No circumstance will take that thing out of my heart. Because it's a conviction. That's why marriages are not broken. Because they are covenants. Covenants are convictions. And convictions can never be taken out of you. Ha! Oh, Lord, have mercy on me. Hi, Pedele. You're going to go to the door. So that's late childhood wounding. And late childhood wounding has a lot to do with either families that are already broken or relationships that have gone totally south, that gone south. Lonely children who are left to their devices, and literal devices as well. Technological devices. They grow up lonely. They have learned that the world that's most important is around them and is made up of buttons that work, not people that need care. The world around them is a world of instants. Go to the microwave, warm food, press the button, it works. So then they meet a person and they say, okay, so where are your buttons? Now press here, you smile. Now press here, you talk. When I press here, you stop hurting me. When I press here, you're present. When I press here, you serve me. And you must never tell me I'm wrong, because where I grew up, there was nobody to tell me that. So they get wounded that way. Some get wounded by violent parents. Some get wounded by divorcing parents. Some get wounded by just being in a home, even a pastor's home. Yeah, if you're here and you're a PK, it's possible to be wounded. Why? Because of expectation. The world around you expects you to be your father. And they judge you on the merits of your father. You know, you, your father, you're thinking, I am not my father. And there are two things that wound PKs. One is expectation. The second thing is, if their father, who is a pastor, or their mother, who is a pastor, does not live out Christian values, L-I-V-E, live out Christian values at home, and the relationships are collapsed. Then they listen to this person preach. At some point, they stop listening to them preach. It destroys their lives. And I can bet, I don't usually bet, so I will not bet. And take this to the bank. I think that's a better expression. And take this to the bank. Every PK that you see, who is wayward, that's what went wrong. So don't wonder anymore. Don't wonder. That's what happened. Then you come into teens. By the time you're doing 7 to 12, let me tell you why 12 is an important part of life. 12 is a place when you begin life. You begin to express the things that have been impressed. That's why Jesus went to the temple at age 12 and he began to talk to the grown-ups about the things of God. Those of us who are in the mainline churches, we do our confirmation and commissioning at age 12, because by 12, everything that's supposed to be in you should be in. A 12-year-old can pick this mic and preach. The message may not be as deep as mine, but they have enough framework. So they need to be commissioned to do ministry. But that is why then, if the wrong thing was impressed, they start expressing rebellion. That's what it. When they then begin to express rebellion, you get a totally different set of wounding that happens to them. And it's mainly rejection. It's rejection based. People label them. They say so-and-so's daughter is spoiled. So-and-so's son is spoiled. Don't associate with them. They mark them. And they tell people, don't associate with that one. That one is a spoiled person. And before you know it, you really have no friends. And the more you have no friends, the more you have no relationships, you know what happens to you? You begin to look for crutches. And the biggest crutch we have nowadays is twofold. One is called sex, the other is called drugs. Because the emptiness just hits. Remember they are empty, but remember they are also exposed to gadgets. I think last time I told you about waves. Did I tell you about waves? Yeah. You know about the five types of waves? It's air waves. We talked about what? Radio waves. Three, we talked about what? Televisual waves. Then we talked about brain waves. Number four. And number five, we talked about gamma rays from the sun. We said those are the things that influence people the most. The waves. You take waves and you add on to those broken relationships, you have a rebellious generation. You have fuel and you have fire. By the time people are done with teens, usually it's time for them to either come back to God or they face an early grave without destiny. So either, that's why, that's what explains why a lot of people come to the Lord when they are teens. They reach the end of themselves. They reach the end of emptiness. They drink till they can't see anything. All these things, you know, hashtag ifikiwazazi, all that. Don't be too, what's the word? I want you to be very concerned, but not to be bamboozled or mystified by it. It falls within the purview and the province of what I've explained to you. It's neglected children seeking attention. We have to give them the right attention. The right attention is to love them and to train them in the fear of God. Not to label them and reject them further. They're already labeled, they're already rejected, so they're not afraid of it. Amen? Okay. So the last piece of part of wounding is teens. By the time you go into your early 20s, you're formed in a certain way. You're either a wounded person, foundations are broken. Everything you try to do will be informed by your broken foundations. So you'll have a litany of broken relationships. Not because there was something necessarily wrong with the person you're related with, but because your foundations are broken. You'll have a litany of lost opportunities, missed out jobs, abandoned projects, unfinished business, because your spirit just does not have the strength to carry out the assignment to completion. There's no follow through. Because your spirit has been leaking out through wood. Alright. That's what I wanted to say to us today. Let me say a few things regarding the passing. God tells the children of Israel a few things in Exodus 15. That he makes a covenant with them. It's called the covenant of healing. In that covenant of healing, he first gives them an object lesson. What is the object lesson? An object lesson is usually a practical lesson. He takes them to a place that has water that is bitter. Remember I told you last time, it's not just human beings who get healed. Even land gets healed. You remember that? And this is one of the passages we said, we talked about water that is bitter, that has diseases in it. We looked at Exodus 23 also, I think from verse 23 to 30, that talks about, I'll take out diseases from your food and water. I think if you watched news this week, our problem is flooding, isn't it? And they're talking about waterborne diseases. You know, in a covenant community, God takes out the diseases from the water. So your water cannot poison you. That's what he said to the Israelites. He said, I'll take away disease from your food and your water. So you cannot be food poisoned and your water cannot kill you. You need to understand these things in perspective. So next week I'm going to bring perspective into this passage of what a covenant community looks like as far as healing is concerned. Because healing is a part of a covenant community. And it's a covenant blessing. Okay. A Jesus even expanded that further. He said to his disciples, if you take poison, and I'm not saying you now go and take poison. He said, don't put the Lord your God to the test. Eh? If you take poison, and I would add that by mistake or by accident, if you take poison, it will not harm you. And there are many Christians who have gone through that. Somebody tried to poison them, and they waited with bated breath for them to drop dead, and nothing happened. Because the Lord neutralized that poison. It's part of the covenant of blessing. Right? Next week we're going to look at keys to healing. And God gave them certain levers in this passage. Next week is going to be quick because we'll also spend some time in actual practical healing. But let me begin by answering some questions that came as last week. And I'll answer just two. What is forgiveness? Forgiveness is a voluntary cancellation of a debt. What's a debt? A debt is an offense. So forgiveness is a voluntary cancellation of a debt. A debt is an offense. They need to come and tell you, I hurt you, I'm sorry. But because we live in a world where we have too many jehuris who will not come and tell you that, and who will feel good because you're waiting for an apology which will never come, God invented something called forgiveness, which is unconditional and does not wait for the apology to come in order for it to be activated. Forgiveness is a choice you make. It's a choice the offender makes about the offense. No, the offended party, not the offender. The offended party makes the choice to forgive, not the offender. It's the offended. If you're waiting for your dad to apologize to you, it may never happen. But you don't have to live in pain. You can actually decide to forgive. Now, I need to clarify this. The decision to forgive does not heal you. Because forgiveness is not healing. Forgiveness merely begins the process of healing. It releases you. And now I need a bottle. Explain this bottle. I use bottles to explain a lot of things. Imagine that the contents of this water is called pain or wound. Imagine that the container is your heart. And in most of your life, you've been wounded. Can this water come out? Why? Because of this thing, eh? This thing is called your will. You can make a decision. When you make that decision, the contents are still inside. Right? The decision to remove this bottle top from the top of this bottle is called forgiveness. The decision to keep this bottle top tight is called unforgiveness. You understand?
Yes.
Forgiveness must be followed by venting, which is the process of pouring out pain. Are we together? And venting is best done when you take a pen and a notebook and daily write letters to God about people who hurt you. Dear God, today I bring so and so to the cross. He hurt me when he said this. Write and make sure you're in a safe space where you can cry, scream, and wail. Because when you start to write a letter to God, God has a certain habit. This is the habit. Let me steal the secret. My mother tongue says, steal the secret. So that's direct translation. Let me steal a secret for you. God, when you begin to write a letter to him, he begins to pull the pain out. And he brings it to the surface. Most of the time when pain comes to the surface, it chokes you through tears. So you need a safe space where you can scream. If you can't scream, get a pillow. That pillow will help muffle your sound. You still need to scream. You need plenty of tissue because your nose will run and your tears will run and it will be a messy affair. And keep writing because the more you write, the more you empty. And the more you empty, the more God feels this container. fills me with this love. Every bitterness, every wound that gets out, God replaces it with love. And he replaces it with his healing. A healed person is difficult to wound. It's not that he cannot be wounded, but it's difficult to wound. I've been through a lot of pain in my life. It's very difficult to wound me. Why? Because for about 2 or 3 years, I cried. I wrote journals, filled books, bought more books, wrote more journals, cried and cried. And every time I would finish crying, I would say, Lord, I now choose to reaffirm my decision to forgive this person. So I reaffirm it. The decision is made only once, but the reaffirmation is always, because Satan will keep coming and telling you, oh, you know, you never quite forgave, you still feel pain. So that's not true. Let me tell you, this is the last thing I'm saying to Bush that I finish. Hey, God's finishing his work. Pain shares one thing in common with an onion. It comes in layers. When you have peeled off one layer, you come upon another layer. Then you peel it off. Then you come upon another layer. The interesting bit is this. One layer looks like the other. So it is easy for you to think you did zero work yesterday. It's not true. You peeled off a layer yesterday. And today is a different layer that looks like the other layer. But it's not the same layer. So don't stop. Don't stop. Keep going. Keep letting God in. And keep pushing the pain out. Yes.
Yeah. need you to say this prayer. Dear God, I know I've been wounded through primary relationships. My parents, with my siblings, with my friends, close people to me. I've also been wounded and offended through life circumstances. Today, I bring these people and I bring these circumstances to you, for you to heal and to pour your healing into them. I need you to name those people. Name them one by one after the other. Say to all the things they did. Tell it to them. Tell it to Jesus. Tell it to Jesus. Let him. Probably living with collapsed relationships, you really don't have any support system, not even one relationship that can speak life into your heart. That is what we call rejection. It's when you have no one. And it's a poor person that has no one. You can have things, but if you have no one, those things can't help you. And sometimes the only way to get back to the place where God begins to fill you with riches again is back to that passage in Psalm 68. The Father to the fatherless. As husband of the widows, is the Lord in his holy name. The Lord sends the lonely in families. God is beginning to speak to you about people he placed in your life. Those people will probably never change.